working session. Just do a little bit of an introduction. This is a 45-minute training session, but it's really more interactive and engagement than sort of me talking at you for 45 minutes. Having said that, I would ask that you pop your microphones on mute while you're not talking, just to reduce any background noise so we get the best experience for everybody who has joined, please. But if you do have questions or anything that you want to add, which I will be encouraging, we do have the chat box, which you can see on the screen there is the little speech mark, the speech bubble there. And you can pop your messages and questions in there. Or we also have the hand raise function, which is the little hand icon. And if you click that, it'll pop your hand up and I can come to you if you do have any specific questions or anything you want to share. So, I don't think I will have met any of you so far. My name is Charlotte Bryson. I am a business change manager in the Smarter Working team, which sits as part of corporate IT and Smarter Working in NHS England and Improvement. So our team, the function of our team is to sort of share information about business change and to teach people about what business change and smarter working can do, and not just the technical side of it, but the culture as well. So how we can work smarter, and especially at the moment, given the current circumstances, really how we can look after each other and look after our teams with a focus on that smarter working. So in today's session, we're going to focus a little bit on the sort of virtual facilitation and some of the tools that you can use to help improve wellbeing in the context of teams and meetings. And then also we're going to have a little bit of a competition using one of our interactive feedback tools called Menti. So we've got a bit of a quiz. As I said, my team gets very competitive and I'll be able to match compared to the group that joined me last Monday and see if we can get an overall winner to see who wins that quiz. But just again, to show you another tool that you can use for that virtual facilitation and those chats. So, I'm going to start with some tips around Teams meetings. Now, this isn't going to be a training session on how to use Teams or even really how to run a meeting on Teams, but we just want to highlight some key considerations on how you can get the most out of Teams and ensure that you're looking after yourself and that you're looking after your colleagues. And these tips, I know we have some people from external organisations as well, these tips aren't necessarily specific for Teams, it applies to any sort of virtual meetings, and it really is around more of that culture of meetings than the technical side of it. So there's a couple of slides here that have some key points on, and I'm not going to just sit and read them all out. These are available in a slightly different format on the link that Anisha has shared previously. So where all of the documents and recordings and things from this summit will be recorded, there is this information there already. But I'll have a bit of a conversation about some of them. And once we've been through, maybe highlight from your end anything that you think you're doing that we haven't included in here, anything we've missed, for example. So the first thing we always say when you're talking about having a meeting is just check if it's needed. Check if it needs to be a meeting. Could it just be an email? Could it be a telephone call? Does it need to happen? And then we always talk about timings. So in our team and our organisation, certainly for our team and department, we work Monday to Friday and our core business hours are 10 till 4. So we say that we don't have any meetings before 9 or any after 5, and no meetings at the weekend. Now for us in our team, there's a couple of us that are early birds. I'm normally on by 8 at the latest, as are a couple of my other team members. So generally, if one of them needs me, they know that they can get me before 9. But in terms of our sort of team meetings, just to keep it really accessible, we keep them after 9. The other thing that's really important to consider there is the requirements of your team. So it might be that somebody needs to do the school run. So if you're booking your weekly meeting at 3:30 every day or every week, that's not going to be accessible for them to join. So it's just considering the needs of the members of your team as well. The other thing that we started to consider, and there's some areas of NHS England and improvement that are really pushing this and using it to great success, is having 50 or 25 minute meetings. So today's session is 45 minutes. So we started at 15:15, which hopefully, if you were in a meeting or session up until 3, gave you a chance to just stretch your legs, get a fresh cuppa, have a comfort break and do what you needed to do, without having a day where you are just back to back to back in meetings, which, as I'm sure is the same for many of you as it is for me, can happen. So we suggest having these 50 or 25 minute meetings just to allow people that little bit of a break in between of them. We do also say if you're going to have longer meetings, make sure you have breaks built into them. It has been proved in studies that people lose attention after 45 minutes in a meeting. And in a virtual meeting, it can be even less than that. We all know the temptation of seeing your emails that are just there and you could just quickly answer one of them. And I'm sure they won't notice if I quickly just tap an email out. So trying to make sure that you've got those breaks and setting that etiquette in advance is really important for getting the most out of them. One thing that we've also introduced into our team, and we've had a bit of a push on it recently, is using your work mobile, if you're lucky enough to have one, for Teams meetings. So having walking meetings or just even moving away from your desk. So we have an all staff briefing once a fortnight and it's a broadcast, so we can't speak back. We're not going to be sharing slides. We're not going to be taking minutes or notes. So what we've started doing as a team is saying, okay, when we have that, we're going to watch it on our phones. We're either going to go for a walk and listen to it, or we're just going to move to a different part of the house. So I just went and sat on my sofa to listen to it. It was really refreshing. Just focus on the briefing and be in a different environment. Have one of my cats on my knee. And not be thinking about feeling guilty about taking that time away as well. Now, at the moment, obviously, the days are getting shorter. Quite often, I will log on when it's dark and I will log off when it's dark. Opportunity to maybe take a bit of a walk during the day when we're joining those meetings can be really positive. So the last point on here is around cameras. So it's lovely that some of you have chosen to turn your camera on. It's really nice to see your faces. It's definitely nice to see people smiling back at me and nodding, and that's lovely. There isn't an expectation that you would have your cameras on. It's lovely that you have, and I'm all for it. But this one is all talking about respecting people's decisions. So for me, partly having my camera on in a meeting forces me to be engaged, because if I get distracted and just start sitting on my phone like this, everyone in the meeting is going to see. So it forces me to stay focused in that meeting. Other people might not feel comfortable having their camera on, and that could be for any number of reasons. It could be technical issues. It might be that actually they don't want to share their home environment with people, and that's okay. So we just need to be really careful about respecting people's decisions not to switch their camera on, and equally considering when it might be appropriate to have it on. So maybe a one-to-one with your manager, be really good to have that on so you can have that body language a little easier than you can certainly on a phone call. And then these are more, again, about etiquette. So taking a lunch break. When I was in the office, I was bad for not taking a lunch break. Now, I'm possibly even worse. I'll run downstairs to my kitchen, grab some food, run back upstairs, and then sit at my desk and eat it. And as much as I love my office, and I'm very fortunate to have a lovely office space, It is nice to get out of it every now and again. So as a team, we're really encouraging this culture of taking a lunch and certainly facilitating that by not booking meetings from 12 till 1. So understanding that trying to get time in diaries is really difficult, but when people are in meetings from 9 till 5, just not having a lunch break can be the straw on the camel's back. So trying to avoid booking those meetings and things in over lunchtime. And then around sort of the etiquette of being in a meeting. And this is all things that people have started to do anyway since we've been working virtually. But things like using your hands up function, using the team's chat. I think what we found quite often as a team, we are quite geographically spread. So we've always had our team's calls virtually. And there are some members of our team who are chatters. And there are others that are reflectors and just like to have a little bit of a moment to think about things. Using the hands up function means that everybody has opportunity to participate. Using the team chat, if somebody actually doesn't want to put their hand up and speak, having that chat option there just allows people to still feel like they're able to participate in the meeting. It's also a bit of a point of chairing, trying to manage those conversations and trying to encourage that feedback. And certainly the interactive feedback tool that I'm going to show you can help with that. We always suggest that you introduce yourself when you're speaking nice and clearly. Microsoft Teams certainly does have closed captioning available, and it's really good. It's not perfect, but it's really, really good. But it works best when you speak slowly and clearly. So I'm quite fortunate to have a fairly neutral accent anyway, and it really comes out when I'm training. I have a training voice, so I deliberately slow down and enunciate and speak very clearly. But if that's not how you naturally speak, or if you get overexcited and rush ahead, then just consider that taking that moment to speak slowly, to enunciate, and make sure that everybody in your team can understand what you're saying and can hear you. Again, the muting the microphone is something that people do pretty automatically now anyway. And then in terms of the camera, I'm really bad. I haven't blurred my background today. But making sure that you're sitting in front of the camera, you've got good lighting, you haven't got a light right behind you that's blurring you out. And consider using the blur background feature. So if we go into our background effects, you'll see that we can either blur our background like that, or we recommend using a fairly plain and neutral background. And that just helps if people have sensory processing difficulties, for instance. It can be really difficult to have lots of videos on the screen at once. So having lots of people with lots of videos and lots of backgrounds, like my usual background of lots of books in different colours, can be really distracting for people. So using sort of the plain backgrounds or the blur feature can really help with that. Again, especially if you have other people in your house and you might have people walking back and forwards behind you, which you can't avoid, then using that blur function again just helps minimize that distraction. So the things I've talked about there, great, but they're a bit boring because it's all about meetings and work. What I want to hear from you and what we want to have a bit of a conversation about is how can you replace things like the water cooler moments? So how can you make sure that, just gonna stop sharing that. How can you make sure that you're still able to have those less formal check-ins, or when you'd go to the kitchen to make a cup of tea and bump into someone and have those chats? How can we use our technology and smarter working to help with that? So if anybody has done anything like that, or you've got anything that you want to share, please pop a message in the chat or pop your hand up. But I'll also tell you something, a little bit about what we're doing in our team. So as a team, we have a weekly comms call, and that's at the beginning of the week. We all get together and we talk about work. We talk about our priorities. We talk about what's coming up this week. Is there anything that needs cover? Have we learned anything in the last week? Any lessons learned and best practices and that sort of thing? We do always start with a bit of a check-in, sort of the how are yous and everything, but it is more work focused. So what we also do on a Friday is a checkout meeting. So we all get together, as many of us that can, and we just have a bit of fun. So we talk about something that we've achieved that week. And it does not have to be work-related. Somebody once said, I managed to fit my shower myself. I was very impressed with that one. But something you've achieved this week. And then what are you up to this weekend? What plans have you got? We then do something different. So we'll do a quiz or a game. And this is where we get quite competitive. So we've done all sorts of things. We've had our videos on and we've done charades. We've used a whiteboard tool to play Pictionary. We've done Articulate. That was a fun one. And if we do use the quiz, I'm going to do a quiz with you and we're going to use Menti to go through that quiz with you. Now, Menti is a brilliant interactive tool. It can be used for work as well. So you can use it in meetings to sort of have people asking questions, tell you how you're feeling. It's completely anonymous, so you can get more of that feedback. But it's also a great tool for that informal conversation. Another thing that I experienced when I went to a team to their meeting to do a bit of training for them, they said at the start of this meeting, we always ask a non-work related question and everyone has to answer it. It's quite a small bunch. So they made me answer it. And the question was snog, marry, avoid political leaders. So I was asked to say whether I would snog, marry or avoid Donald Trump, Vladimir Putin and Boris Johnson. It was a very tough decision. But having those sort of non-work related fun little questions at the beginning of their session just helps like they're all being checked in and able to have those sort of silly conversations that you would naturally have in the office. So is there anything that you're doing at the moment that you want to tell me about? Amy.
I was just going to say we have we use Teams and we have different threads going, and one's called Too Many Cooks, so that's just all of our recipes and lunch ideas and things like that. And there's another one dedicated to the pets, and then we had a Halloween one and stuff like that, so that's just quite silly, but it's a nice that's way brilliant. To talk about non-work things.
Yeah, that's brilliant. So having those sort of informal chats, and Teams chats is a really good way to do that. We have a Smarter Working team chat and we always start our morning with a bit of a GIF competition. So we'll just pop a little GIF in and run with the theme for the day. So it's a really good one. Thank you, Beth. Amy, you've got your hand up.
Yeah, we do things very similar to what you've already touched on, to be honest. It was interesting what you said about that non-work question. I'm from a different organisation, just jumping in to try and get some tips, especially around, like you say, those water moment, the moments where we want to help people's well-being by still having those informal chats. And how do you do that virtually? So it was really, that's why I was tuning in. So it was great to hear that obviously we're talking about this. But we are a marketing team that has grown and grown, and we're now about 30 people, which in one way is great because we've got all the creativity, but you do have lots of different people on those calls, those that are talkers, like you say, like myself, more than happy to come on and chat. And it's interesting because you'll get very different people on the chat, putting their suggestions over there. And I think what's the struggle we've had is we used to do this face to face, and it is very different to what we did face to face, because we used to do that non-work question. We've done snog, marry, avoid ourselves, we've done stuff that might be themed, like what's your gay icon, that type of thing. And we've done loads of different themes around the question, but we actually stopped it going into virtual because there were so many of us, it just wasn't the same. But what we did do is introduce things that we've not done previously, like the quizzes, we've had themed quizzes, we've not done charades, but I think that's coming next. We've just switched it up slightly just because of how big the group is. We do our meeting on a Thursday because we have a few people in the team that work on a Friday that don't work on Fridays because they do the 4-day weeks. So obviously, bearing in mind that when we do plan it, whether that's drinks after work, virtual drinks after work, to bear in mind those people that can't do it on a Friday. And then again, because we have a big team, we then break it off into smaller groups, and sometimes they might do a meeting on a Monday where there's only five of them, and you can get a bit more personal on those.
Yeah. Brilliant. No, that's great. That's really good to hear. And it's great that you are sort of breaking that down into smaller groups as well. So for us as a Smarter Working team, we're a really small team. I think there's seven of us in the team at the moment. And then corporate IT and Smarter Working as a wider, there's about 60 people. So for the checkout, and we don't always get everybody come to those, but that goes out to everyone. And then our comm cell, it's just sort of for us to get together as a team. And then even smaller than that, we all sort of have little buddies. So everybody knows that if they've had a really frustrating meeting and they just need to pick up the phone and go, oh, there's somebody in the team that they can speak to. So just sort of lining up those little buddies and things. It's brilliant. Katie, I'll come to you next.
Yeah, it's just great to hear all those things that happened. And I think we sort of started as a team, sort of in the population health team and the partnership, sort of doing more of the quiz that we started off doing that very enthusiastically. But we've also got running alongside, which I think was running before March, was a book club. So a virtual book club. So that's really good to go to. And you don't even sort of, I mean, you know, the mantra is you don't have to be reading a book, but just get together and, you know, fit that into your diary. And then definitely sort of the coffee breaks, but making time to put that in. Actually, I think it's something about making time to put that into your diary to say I'm going to have a catch up with somebody else who we don't necessarily work that closely with within the wider team. That's been really useful. Just something that I was doing that I found really useful as well, just to be trying to be strict with myself, was to put when I could sort of my timer on the phone like every hour. So once that was the hour was up, I was like, oh, I've just got to do another eat. No, the timer's gone off. So I'm going to get up, move away from the laptop and just literally, you know, make a brew or just walk and just stretch my legs. I found that really good and just really, really helped me because like you say, you can be, if you are in back to backs and you're there all day and it's just, you know, it's not good, is it, physically and mentally?
Yeah.
But definitely echoing a lot of those. And I've also done this. I've done this sort of on a pet. So people that I know that, as you say, you'd sort of bump into around the water cooler from the wider teams, I've gone and made virtual appointments with those people, which has been really useful. And then just people who I'm working with as stakeholders, I've said, right, let's catch up for a virtual brew. And the difference it makes just to be talking through, you know, our work. And I just think, why don't I do this more often? You know, but we've become sort of, as you know, attached to our laptops. But no, it's really Absolutely. Useful listening to you.
No, brilliant. That's really useful to hear as well. And I think you're right about booking that time in. I don't know about any of you, but I think I found that a lot of colleagues were finding when we started working from home, we sort of had to justify our time. And I think it's maybe different now than it was at the beginning of lockdown. But when a lot of our organisation weren't used to really working from home or working from home routinely, we were finding that we had to put loads of meetings in our diary to prove that we were working and to show that we were really busy. And we've just sort of got into that habit of doing it. And it's why the very first point on those slides that I showed you is, does it need a meeting? Do you need to have a meeting, or could you have a quick catch up? Could you have a call with someone and, you know, have that virtual brew and be able to chat it through with them that way? So brilliant. It's really good to hear what you're all doing. As I said, we are going to do a little bit of a competition. So we're going to do a quiz, and I'm going to share my screen now. And hopefully you will be seeing that now. And we're going to use a tool called Menti. So Menti is, as I say, it's a virtual interactive feedback tool. Some of you might have used it before, but it's really easy to use a phone, or you can open up a web browser if you prefer. But you're going to go to www.menti.com, and I've just popped that in the chat box for you. And you're going to enter the code that's on the screen there, so 93 42 69 8, and it will bring you into this quiz. So there we go, we can see we've got a couple of you on already. That's great. And once it's brought you in, you'll see you get a little icon. We've got someone very festive already. I know you don't get to pick your icon. The other thing you can do is in the bottom right hand corner, you can see how many people are on. So for instance, I can see that there were 8 people. Anisha's just joined back in, so 9 people on the call, and 7 people have been able to join. 8, perfect. So obviously if you do have a really big group and you've only got sort of 10 people on, but you've got 50 people in the meeting, it's a really good way of sort of gauging where people are at with that. So just before we get started, there is one more thing that I need to do that I hadn't done. So let me just move this up. Just thinking about it, we're going to move that down here. Okay, so the idea of the quiz is that you get more points the faster you answer a question. They are all multiple choice, so give it a go. You can ask different questions if you want when you're setting these up. I've gone for multiple choice just to make it a little bit easier. So nice and straightforward to do then. Let's go for the first question. So fingers at the ready. Here we go. First question, what is the common name of the Aurora Borealis? So is it Southern Flashes, Western Flames, Northern Lights, or Eastern Flickers? Let's see, everyone's voted. Everyone got that one. So I'll start you easy, get you comfortable. So that's the Northern Lights. So in the next page, you'll see the leaderboard. We'll see everybody got it. Who was the fastest? Sal was the fastest. Well done, Sal. Okay, so next question then. Okay, oh, hang on. Here we go. Next question. So again, fastest finger first. Who is fifth in line to the British throne? See some calculations there. We've got Prince Harry, Princess Charlotte, Prince Louis, and Princess Eugenie. Okay, let's see who got that one. 4 of you got that right. It is Prince Louis. Well done. So we'll see what that's done to the leaderboard. So, brilliant. I think Lola was the fastest. Well done. Okay, so it's all to play for at this early stage of the quiz. So question 3, how many sitting presidents have been assassinated? Is it 3, 4, 5, or 7? Bonus points if you can tell me who they are. 3 of you got that one right, it is 4. I don't know if I can remember them all. JFK, Abraham Lincoln, and 2 others. There were 4. If anybody does know who the 4 are, please. I think Andrew Garfield might have been one of them. Okay, so Lola has taken the lead there. Well done, Lola. Okay, so question 4 then. In the Jungle Book, what creature is Baloo? Is Baloo a tiger, a wolf, a snake, or a bear? Yeah, so almost all of you got that one. Baloo is a bear. I was an Arcala back in the day. I was a cub leader, so I wasn't sure if that was too easy or not. Let's see what that's done to the points then. Okay, so I think Lola might, oh no, maybe not. Sal was the fastest. Sal and Lola have the fastest fingers here, fastest responses. Okay, question five then. Okay, what do you call a group of jellyfish? Is it a bouquet, a bloom, a blossom, or a floret? Okay, so four of you knew that it was a bloom. If you knew it, did you know it, Noah, or was it a guess? Be honest. Amy shaking her head saying no, it was a guess. Okay, let's see who's got that one. Okay, well done. You guessed the fastest, Amy. There you go. Okay, so let's have a look at the next question then, question six. So what has the chemical symbol Zn? Is it nickel, lead, zirconium, or zinc? Everyone's voted. Most of you got that one. Sorry, zirconium was a bit of a trick question there, a trick answer. It is zinc. Okay. Let's see who's the fastest there. Oh, Jill might have been the fastest on that one. Well done, Jill. Okay. So we've got question seven. In what TV series does actress Gillian Anderson play a sex therapist? Is it The X-Files, Sex Education, Emily in Paris, or Black Mirror? Everyone's voted there. Most of you got that one. It was Sex Education. If you haven't already watched it, it's very good. Would definitely recommend on Netflix. Okay, let's see who got that one and who was the fastest. Oh, I think Sal. Yeah, I think Sal was the fastest there. Well done. It's pushed Amy up to the lead. Okay, last question then. This one needs just a little bit of prep. Oh. Hang on one second. Okay, so for this one, we need to just do that. Are you ready? Okay. Name this iconic song by the Bangles. There you go. Most of you got that one. I like the threatening Thursday suggestion, but it was in fact Manic Monday. Okay. So let's see who managed to get that one. And who was the quickest? I think Sal was the quickest. Let's see. Oh, it's pushy up to third, Sal, but Amy is our overall winner. Well done. So the purpose of Menti is just to make it that little bit more fun and engaging on the end of a Friday. You can of course do quizzes in all sorts of ways. We've done just verbal quizzes, we've done quizzes on PowerPoint and asked people just to write down their questions, and we've done quizzes where we ask people to sort of shout out. Menti obviously has that extra visual element to it. It's just a little bit more techy and can be really great for sort of just having those less formal chats. We normally get a little bit of trash talk going on while we're doing the quizzes. People, as I say, get very competitive. And we take it in turns to create those quizzes. So we nominate different people from the team to run them. So it's not just one person having to come up with it every week. But just sort of wanted to give you a little bit of an idea of what can be possible. So Menti is a tool. If you are within NHS England and Improvement, we do have a number of corporate licenses available if you do want to use it. And you can access those by emailing us. And I'm just going to pop our email address in the chat box. if you are outside of NHS England and Improvement, there is a free version of Menti available, although it does have some limitations. So I think you can only ask 3 questions, and I don't know if you can use the quiz feature within it. But it might be something that you want to take to your IT department to look at getting corporate licenses. And it might be that you have some sort of similar software that you're able to use. But obviously we use Menti, so just wanted to sort of highlight that to you. So what I would really like you to do just in the last few minutes before we finish up is pop into the chat box and let me know one commitment that you're going to make off the back of this session. So are you going to commit to booking in a lunch break every day? Are you going to ask your team to do 50 minute and 25 minute meetings? Are you going to implement a checkout? Are you going to book in those coffee breaks like Katie was saying, but something that you're going to take away from this session to improve your wellbeing and a different way that you can use smarter working for that. Beth's definitely saying 50 minute meetings. That's great. Amy's going to commit to the walk and talk meetings. It's a really good one. Yeah. Suggesting some team activities, Dawn. Yeah, that's brilliant. And I think the team bonding in those activities is always really good. And when we do it as a wider team, it means I get to speak to people that I don't actually speak to normally in a work setting. I don't have any projects that overlap with them. So it's really nice to have those checkouts and have that sort of team session. Booking in, checking meetings, that's great. Making time between meetings, not back to back, to rehydrate and breathe. Yeah, that's a really good one. And actually, Katie was saying about timer to go off every hour, I've started using something called the Pomodoro technique, which suddenly, I don't know if it's been around for a very long time and has suddenly become very popular over the last month or two. But I've heard a couple of people in our organisation using it. But the principle is similar. So you set a timer for 25 minutes. And you set the tasks that you want to achieve in that 25 minutes and you work solidly at it for 25 minutes and then you have a 5 minute break. And I think every 3 or 4 revolutions of that, you have a longer break afterwards. You have sort of a 20 to 30 minute break afterwards. I found that it's really good for helping me focus when I've got a lot that I want to do and a lot that I need to get through and I don't really know where to start. Having that tool just really helps me focus and set down what I want to achieve and really get through it. There's all sorts of different ones online. I use one called Pomo Focus, so I can pop that in the chat box for you. And it allows you to sort of set your tasks in there and set your timer. It does a nice buzzer when you're finished and goes to blue. So definitely something that I've used. And again, Katie said going to book more virtual coffee breaks with team members and others. So that's great to hear. Brilliant. Well, thank you very much for joining, everyone. I hope that this has been useful. I hope that you've learned something new. You've had some fun in the session. If you do have any other questions, please do email us at england.smarterworking@nhs.net. Let us know what you're doing. Share your successes with us as well. If you don't have a question to ask us, but you want to tell us about something great that you're doing, please do. Whether you're in NHS England and Improvement or in an external organisation, we're really keen to hear from you. It was really great speaking to you all today. Thank you very much for attending and we'll speak to you again soon.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone.
Winning the quiz has made my week. I never win quizzes.